Well, I think that the thing that really bothered a lot of people was the whole sleeping in the same bed as Michael. And even though I think most people understand this is not like a twin size bed, you know, this is probably some gigantic
It
bed.
was bigger than the building we're in. You know, when you talk about Michael Jackson's bedroom, you're talking about a building that's bigger than where we are filming today. I mean, this was a huge, huge area. And parents would stay on the bed, sisters would stay on the bed, brothers would stay on the bed. It wasn't at all what the prosecution was trying to spin it as being. And, you know, unfortunately, Michael was well-meaning. There was nothing sexual about any of this. He was nice to everybody. I had parents testify that they had slept in his room. I mean, it wasn't at all what the prosecution was portraying it as being. And that's the thing about a courtroom. It's a reconstruction of reality. The prosecution tries to make reality look this way, the defense tries to make reality look this way, and the jury decides who's correct.
Well, at one point, he was actually charged for the abuse, and the police ended up raiding Neverland Ranch, where they took everything they could possibly take. Well, and like you said earlier, Johnny Cochran actually told Michael to use you as a lawyer.
Well, Johnny Cochran and Howard Weitzman had represented Michael in the early 1990s in the case that settled in 1994. I was not involved in that case. When he was charged in 2003, Randy and his brother and Michael talked to Johnny Cochran, who recommended me. Now, at first, I wouldn't take the case because I was tied up with Robert Blake. And I was. I'll never forget the day Neverland was raided by 70 sheriffs and their assistants. I kept getting phone calls from Las Vegas, where Michael Jackson was staying, asking if I would immediately jump on a plane and come to Las Vegas. And I said, I can't do it because I'm tied up with the Robert Blake case, which is going to trial in February. I'm feverishly getting ready to try this case. And they just were amazed that anybody would say, I can't do this.
Right.
But I couldn't do both. And eventually, Robert Blake and I had a falling out, and I withdrew from the case during jury selection. And as soon as I did that, Randy Jackson called me and said, are you available now? We've always wanted you. And I said, well, that's very flattering. Why don't I meet your brother and we'll see where it goes? So I was secretly flown to Orlando, Florida. I was put in a limousine and taken to a home and interviewed by Michael Jackson and his people. And that was the first time I'd ever met him. Now, he hardly said a word during that meeting. He stayed in the back. He stared at me very intently. And his people were asking me questions about who I was and my background and the cases I'd done, et cetera. I left the next day wondering if I'd ever hear from him again. And shortly after that, Randy Jackson called me and said, my brother said, you're the one. So one thing led to another, and I was retained.
Okay, so you have this initial meeting and then you become Michael Jackson's official lawyer. At that point, do you guys start to talk more and have more conversations and start to really dig into this whole situation?
Well, yes, I would go to Neverland. We would have meetings. We would talk about various aspects of evidence. When I start a case, my attitude is I don't believe anybody. I don't believe the prosecution. I don't believe the defense. I don't trust anything. I want to see for myself what's going on. So I realized what these allegations were. I realized that he'd been accused of this before. And I met with him, I believe, with a very open mind to try and figure out who Michael Jackson was and what kind of a case this was. And it didn't take me very long to conclude he would never harm a child. He would never molest a child. This made no sense, that he was just a target of opportunism of various forms. Prosecutors wanted to be stars. People wanted to sue him. If he were convicted, he would be disabled. Anybody and their mother's uncle could file a lawsuit. How would he defend himself in prison? I mean, I realized what a phenomenal target he was. He was the most famous person on the planet. He was one of the wealthiest people on the planet. He owned the catalog, which included Beatles music and other great artists. I mean, he was such a target, and he was also perceived as not someone who would want to fight a case. He was received as very gentle, very childlike, very creative, someone who danced to their own drummer. And he was just such a phenomenal target. I don't think in my lifetime I'll ever see a bigger target for opportunists than Michael Jackson.